In a casualty, a mother came with a 2-year-old boy complaining of incessant cry since 2 hours. It was around night casualty, around 10 p.m. and the child was crying from 7 to 8 p.m. that day. When I looked at him, he was pulling his ears occasionally along with crying. And this such cases can also come in pediatric casualties. And another patient, a 48-year-old male, he came to the casualty like this. There was severe pain, but he was complaining as if there was something went into the ear while he was sleeping. It was also in a night casualty. In both these cases, there was a preceding history of an upper respiratory infection. And without looking at the into the ear, without examining the ear, you can tell the diagnosis, and it is acute otitis media or AO. Okay. And what is this acute otitis media? You know that in the middle ear, it's tympanic membrane. Your malleus, incus and the stapes assembly, and anterior wall comes the eustachian tube. Okay, so the otitis media is inflammation of the middle ear cleft. And what is this middle ear cleft? Middle ear cleft is, it's already described along with the anatomy of my middle ear. Okay, anatomy. It is already discussed in detail along with the anatomy of middle ear. Okay, so the middle ear cleft is the middle ear space along with the eustachian tubal opening and posteriorly the mastoid diastole and the way. How will you reach the mastoid diastole from middle ear? From the adductus and through the antrum. Okay, so the middle ear space along with the eustachian tube and the adductus, antrum and the mastoid diastole, that will constitute the middle ear cleft. So inflammation of the middle ear cleft is called the otitis media, and broadly otitis media is divided into acute otitis media and secretory otitis media. So about the secretory otitis media, we already discussed in detail in my class on otitis media with effusion. Okay, if any doubt, you go and see that class. So, and acute, when we call it as an acute attack, when it is less than 3 weeks. So, acute otitis media is pyogenic infection of the middle ear cleft with less than 3 weeks duration. Clear? It is acute otitis media. And it is more commonly seen in children around 2 years of age than in adult. Why? Because there are some differences between an adult eustachian tube and an infant eustachian tube. I am not discussing it again here. It is already discussed in my class on anatomy of eustachian tube. Okay. So the main risk factor, you know, the main opening, the only sole opening from exterior into the middle ear space is through the eustachian tube. Okay, there is also another opening which is adductus communicating with the mastoid diastole, but it is not communicating with the exterior space. Okay, so only through the eustachian tubal opening the middle ear space is communicating with the exterior or the atmosphere, isn't it? And this is opening into the nasopharynx. Okay, this is opening into the nasopharynx. Right? So, the main predisposing factor for an acute otitis media is the eustachian tube dysfunction. Right? So, any infections in the nose and the nasopharynx causing eustachian tube dysfunction will cause and predispose to an acute otitis media. There are some more other conditions which can predispose, like bottle feeding and the infection from the bottle fed milk or from the bottle will go through this eustachian tube into the middle ear. And then overcrowding, bad unhygienic living conditions, then smoking, both passive and active. How smoking affect this? Smoking will affect the nasociliary action. So the cilia beating will be reduced in the case. And then viral infections prevailing at home, then daycare centers. Again, all these will contribute to or will predispose to chance of infection and again leading to an acute otitis media. So all this, bottle feeding or an attendance in daycare centers, overcrowding, allergy, passive and active smoking, all this will lead to eustachian tube dysfunction leading to acute otitis media. And some more associated conditions. Again, what is that? Cleft palate. Then immunodeficiency disorders, ciliary dyskinesia, cystic fibrosis, Down syndrome. In all these conditions, what happens? Again, there is ciliary dysfunction. Okay, which all conditions? Cystic fibrosis, then cleft palate, immunodeficiency, ciliary dyskinesia, Down syndrome. All these conditions, the child or adult predisposing or more in chance of getting an acute otitis media. Discuss about acute otitis media under all these headings. Definition, predisposing factors, then the etiopathogenesis, the causative organism, clinical features, diagnosis, differential diagnosis, treatment, and indications of meibomotomy in a case of acute otitis media. Okay, coming first to a definition, I already told it is an inflammation or the pyogenic infection of the middle ear cleft of less than 3 weeks duration. That is important. Acute is less than 3 weeks. What are the predisposing factors? That is already told again. Mainly the eustachian tube dysfunction, any conditions causing a defective eustachian tube function, like viral infections, then infections of the nose and paranasal sinus, any tumors in the nasopharynx, and most common in children is an adenoid hypertrophied adenoid causing recurrent infections, adenoid hypertrophy or adenoiditis. Okay, then all everything I have discussed already. And etiopathogenesis, again, the route of infection can be through any means. Infection should reach the middle ear. So the one commonest entry is through the eustachian tube. So it can be through the eustachian tube. And what can be other entries? What comes here? Here comes the tympanic membrane. So if there is a pre-existing perforation of the tympanic membrane, this bacteria can come through this. Okay, so one is here, pathogen coming through eustachian tube, another coming through the already perforated tympanic membrane, or one more thing, what is here? It is a temporal bone, isn't it? So if there is a fracture of temporal bone, again this can come. Okay. So this bacteria can come through a fracture of temporal bone, or as usual there can also be a blood-borne infection. Okay, so through eustachian tube, through a perforated tympanic membrane, through a fracture of temporal bone or blood bone. So there are four routes of infection reaching the middle ear. Okay, through the eustachian tube, through a perforated tympanic membrane, or through fracture of temporal bone, or hematogenous or blood bone. Then there are also some other conditions which predispose to this opening through this. One is a reduced immunity of the patient, or if there is an exanthematous fever, again causing a reduced immunity, or barotrauma, or there is palatal disorders or food allergy to anything. Okay, nasal allergy, right? So all these will predispose to chance of getting the infection, and the main spread is through these four routes, right? The definition, the predisposing factors, etiopathogenesis. And what about the bacteriology? The commonest one is a streptococcus pneumonia, right? That is why we a trial of pneumococcal vaccination or influenza vaccines will reduce the occurrence of acute rotavirus media. Okay, the commonest organism is a streptococcus pneumonia, and H influenza and Moraxella catarrhalis is also commonly causing this acute rotavirus media. And there is also virus. Viral etiology is also seen. One is a respiratory syncytial virus, and others like rhinovirus and adenovirus can also cause. So the commonest bacteria is a streptococcus pneumonia. It is also caused by H influenza and Moraxella catarrhalis, and viral etiology, mainly respiratory syncytial virus, rhinovirus and adenovirus. Okay. Then what about the clinical features? Usually we can divide the natural course into 5 stages. Okay. The first one is when there is involvement or infection of the eustachian tube, what will happen? There will be edema. In all conditions, when there is infection, there will be an inflammation, isn't it? So this inflammation will cause edema. What happened when edema? This will get edematous. So there will be a block. So that is stage of tubal occlusion. The eustachian tube get occluded. So this is the first stage. Tubal occlusion. Okay, so that is tubal occlusion. Then what will happen? If there is a tubal occlusion, the air will not reach into the middle ear, isn't it? So what happened? There will be negative pressure. So it is a stage of pre-separation. First there is a negative pressure phase. So that is pre-separation. Separation means something is oozing into the middle ear. Just before separation, it comes a pre-separation. And third, if there is a pre-separation, the third stage should be a stage of separation. Okay. And after separation, what happened? Something is oozing into the middle ear. What happened? The middle ear will bulge or fill with the separated fluid. And then at this one stage, which part is easy to break? The thinnest area. Of this, all these are bone except the tympanic membrane. Right? So the tympanic membrane will perforate or it will break. And then what happened? This fluid will, once there is a tubal occlusion, there is a separative phase, then there is pre-separative, going for separation. So fluid is getting collected, pus is getting collected in the middle ear. And at this stage, this tympanic membrane will rupture and this pus will come out. Okay. So that is a stage of resolution. And either this can, after the letting out the pus, this can go for healing phase, or it can go for a complication phase. Okay, so the fourth one is, I'll write it here, resolution, and fifth is complication. Tubal occlusion, then leading to a pre-separation, then separation, then after breaking the pus into the external artery canal, it can go for resolution or for complication. In general, we can tell the common symptoms. As a neonate, it will be irritable with the feeding difficulty. Okay, because this neonate and small children cannot tell the main complaints, so neonate will be irritability, and also difficulty in feeding. And in, if it is in older children, there will be fever and otalgia. And the child will cry because of earache. Adult, the mainly complaining of pain along with the hearing loss. Okay, adult. Adult is mainly conductive hearing loss along with the ear pain. So these are the common complaints in all the various age categories. And when coming to each stage with the symptoms and signs. In the stage of tubal occlusion, there is edema and hyperemia of the nasopharynx along with the eustachian tube. So this eustachian tube will not open properly, so that this middle ear pressure maintenance is altered. So what happened? There is an air that get absorbed and it will create a negative middle ear pressure. Understood? So what will happen here? It will be sucking effect. This will be negative phase. It's middle ear get a vacuum effect. So the complaint will be deafness and a fullness of ear. There will be a hearing loss, and also the patient will complaining of ear fullness, and there won't be any fever. At this stage, there is no fever. That is important. And on examination, what will you see? Because there is negative middle ear pressure, this eustachian tympanic membrane is pulled into the middle ear. Okay, this tympanic membrane will be pulled in. On examination, there will be a retracted tympanic membrane, and also there will be a conductive hearing loss when you do a 24 test. And that next is a stage of pre-suppuration. What is that? Tubal occlusion, we have find out at that stage, and if a correct treatment is given, this will revert back to normal. If no treatment is given, there will be prolonged tubal occlusion that will facilitate invasion of bacteria. So there will be mucosal hyperemia, and there will be inflammatory exudate. Okay, so a prolonged tubal occlusion will leading to a mucosal hyperemia here. Prolonged negative effect, there will be mucosal hyperemia, and there will be inflammatory exudate. It is the exudate, okay. And to that, the bacterial invasion will occur. All our Streptococcus pneumonia, H. influenza, Moraxella catarrhalis, all will run into the middle ear and will cause an exudate formation. Okay, so there will be marked pain, high fever, bubbling sound in the ear, and deafness will be there. In this stage, there will be this pre-suppurative phase, there will be fever, there will be marked pain, and there is also deafness. So if it is a neonate, he or she cannot tell that I am having a deafness. So the child will be irritable, and there will be difficulty in feeding because of pain, and also there will be high grade fever. What will you get on examination? Here, this negative pressure has turned into a positive pressure because of collection of exudate, and also there will be a marked hyperemia, mucosal hyperemia. So here the tympanic membrane will bulge. Okay, so there will be a bulging tympanic membrane, and there will be a cartwheel appearance. What is it? The tympanic membrane. What is the blood supply? How is the blood supply of tympanic membrane? It is around the periphery, and from the periphery, and also along the handle of malleus and endothelial supply from the periphery. Okay, so this is the blood pattern of blood supply of the tympanic membrane. And if there is mucosal hyperemia, and there is collection of exudate, this tympanic membrane will bulge, along with there will be congestion of the blood vessels. Okay, so that is why this is called the typical cartwheel appearance. Understood? So in the pre-separative phase, on examination, there will be a bulging tympanic membrane, red and congested tympanic membrane, and the typical cartwheel appearance. It's very easy. So in tubal occlusion phase, tympanic membrane is retracted, and in pre-separative phase, it is bulging, red, and typical cartwheel appearance will be there. The patient is not getting correct treatment at the stage of pre-separation. The pus will again will come and form in the middle ear. Once the middle ear is full of pus, it will go through the adductus into the mastoid. And also there will be bulging of the tympanic membrane. So what happened? The pain will increase and also there will be increasing deafness and there will be constitutional symptoms because of absorption of toxins. Okay, so that is stage of separation. The pus collection in the middle ear as well as in the mastoid. Mastoidiasis, then the increasing pain, increasing deafness and also constitutional symptoms. And on examination, what will you see? Examination, this typical cartwheel appearance will change into a bulging and edematous, bulging tympanic membrane which is congested and there will be a point of yellowish spot. And somewhere here, all these parameters will go, okay. All this landmark will go, this will get bulging and this your handle of malleus will be engulfed in the bulging phase, bulging tympanic membrane. And in some cases you can see a yellow spot where there is an imminent rupture. Some part you will get an yellow spot also. Now it's not a red spot, it's a yellow spot, right? So this whole this tympanic membrane will bulge. So that the handle of malleus will be engulfed within the edematous and congested tympanic membrane. And sometimes you will see, especially in the inferior quadrant, you will see a yellowish spot. As you see in an abscess which is going to rupture, you will see a spot in the summit of bulging. Like that, here also there will be a yellowish spot which is going to rupture. So that is the stage of separation. And there will be mastoid tenderness also. Because of collection of pus in the mastoid, there will be tenderness in the mastoid. And if you take an x-ray, you can see that typical classical clouding of the mastoid acyl with the dissolution of the intercellular septum. This mastoid acyl is actually like honeycomb. There are a lot of mastoid acyl. So all this intercellular septa will be dissolved because of the pressure of the exudate. And you can see clouding in the mastoid acyl in an X-ray mastoid. So that is stage of separation. So in the separative phase, it is bulging, tympanic membrane bulging, bulging, bulging. It is going to rupture. And in the stage of resolution, what will happen? At one point, this will rupture. Okay, at one point, this gets ruptured. And with the relief of with the rupture of the tympanic membrane, all the fluid has gone. So there is no collection, there is no pus collection inside. So the pressure buildup has gone. So the patient will be relieved of symptom. The fever will go and the pain will go. And sometimes there will be also improvement of hearing. And on examination, what will you see? You can't see because it is a pinpoint perforation. It's not big like this. It's only a pinpoint perforation. Okay. So all this pus inside will try to come through this pinpoint perforation. So what will happen? A high pressure area with a small leakage, the whole pus will come out to the out of the middle ear through this pinpoint perforation. So each time there will be a pulsatile discharge, and that we call it as a lighthouse sign. Okay, it is a lighthouse sign. The pulsatile discharge pulsating with a light reflex. So that is called the lighthouse sign. Lighthouse sign. So the pent up secretion trying to escape through a pinhole perforation, presenting as a pulsatile discharge which is seen at light reflex. So it is called the lighthouse sign. So that is the stage of resolution. This is stage of resolution. Okay. So from the resolution, pus can drain through this perforation. It can heal, and in some cases, this will go for stage of complications. So complications of separative otitis media, I'll discuss in next class. Okay. So these are the five stages: tubal occlusion, going for a negative phase, causing a pre-separative phase. Then there is exudate formation. Separative phase, then after separation the separated pus will break through a pinpoint perforation of tympanic membrane. It is the stage of resolution, and if it is going for complication, it is a fifth stage. That is regarding the clinical features. Then diagnosis. How will you diagnose? Diagnosis is easy from a typical history. What is that? There will be a preceding history of upper respiratory infection or is allergic attack. Following that, the patient will present with earache, deafness, oral fullness or ear discharge. So the otoscopy will show either of this. If it is stage 1, there is a retracted tympanic membrane. If it is in stage 2, there will be the cartwheel appearance. In stage 3, there will be bulging tympanic membrane with a yellowish spot, and in stage of resolution, you can see a pinpoint perforation with a lighthouse sign. And in stage of complication, that is depending upon the each complication, the appearance will vary. Okay, so by history and otoscopy, the diagnosis is very easy, and in some cases, we have to go for bacteriology to find out the appropriate antibiotic, culture and sensitivity. And CT scan is usually not needed, and radiology is needed in case of complications. Okay, usually we won't, in a normal case, normal natural course, the CT scan is not needed, and high resolution CT scan of the temporal bone we do in case of suspected complications. So that is about the diagnosis, mainly by typical history and otoscopy. Regarding the differential diagnosis, what are the differential diagnosis? All causes of otalgia comes in differential diagnosis. All causes of otorrhea, ear discharge, again comes in differential diagnosis. For this causes of otalgia and causes of otorrhea, different types of ear discharge, just see my class on examination of ear. It is beautifully described in that. So the causes of otalgia comes under differential diagnosis. Otorrhea comes under differential diagnosis. Then other differential diagnosis are otitis externa, again pain. Then meningitis bullosa. Then trauma to the ear, again a differential diagnosis. And also in a crying child, if the child is crying incessantly, maybe due to abdominal pain or due to any other cause, the otoscopy will be that of an bulging and red congested tympanic membrane. So don't confuse that with an acute otitis media. Okay, in every crying child, when you examine the tympanic membrane, it will be red and bulging. But the difference is that in a crying child, the light reflects that. If you see the tympanic membrane, even if the tympanic membrane is congested, this light reflex will be present. In a crying child, the light reflex on the anteroinferior quadrant will be present, but it will be absent in a case of acute otitis media. So, acute otitis media we can broadly divide into those without complication and those with complications. Okay. So without complication, the first treatment is with amoxicillin, with the cefaclor or azithromycin. In some institutions, the amoxicillin and clavulanic acid is given as a first line antibiotic, and sometimes it is given along with the second line. So especially in pediatric age group, amoxicillin alone is taken as a first line antibiotic. So we give a first line antibiotic. If the patient is better in 2 to 3 days, then only follow up is needed. So So if the patient is getting better in 2 to 3 days, you discharge or send the patient home and ask him to come back for recheck after 4 to 6 weeks. Especially look for middle ear effusion. If there is no middle ear effusion, okay, fine. There is no need of follow-up. If there is middle ear effusion, then treatment of middle ear effusion and again a monthly follow-up is needed. So that is without complication. Give first line antibiotic, patient is better in 2 to 3 days. Ask him to come for a follow-up after 4 to 6 weeks and look for presence of middle ear effusion. And if the patient is not better, that is the second scenario. If the patient is not better in 2 to 3 days, what have to do? You have to go for a second line antibiotic, especially amoxicillin plus clavulanic acid or second or third generation cephalosporins. Give that. Again, two possibilities are there. After second line antibiotic, patient is better in 2 to 3 days. Then you follow this algorithm. Or if the patient is not better, then what will you do? Even after giving with second line antibiotics, the patient is not getting better, then it is an indication for meningotomy and pus for culture and sensitivity. And according to the culture and sensitivity report, treat the patient. Okay. And recheck after 4 to 6 weeks. And if there is complication, you treat the complication and go for meningotomy and send the pus for culture and sensitivity. So this is the treatment management plan according to with complication and without complication. Another usually asked question is, what are the indications of meningotomy in an acute otitis media? This indications. What are the indications of meningotomy? There are 6 indications. One is severe pain, a bulging and red tympani membrane with the very severe pain. Okay, so a bulging red tympani membrane causing excruciating pain is an indication for meningotomy. And second one, with complications. Okay. In all cases of cases going for complication, you have to do that. Third one, an unresolved acute otitis media. See, we gave the second line antibiotic, waited for 2 to 3 days. Even then, it is not resolving. So it is an unresolved otitis media. And the fourth one is an acute otitis media during antibiotic therapy. It's not resolving with the adequate antibiotic therapy. Okay, with antibiotic, not resolving with the antibiotic. You are giving antibiotic first line, second line, IV antibiotic. Even then the patient is not getting better. It is an indication. And another one, fifth one is acute otitis media in immunodeficiency patients. Okay, in patients with immunodeficiency, the chance of complication is very high. So in that case, you have to go for a meningotomy and pus sent for culture sensitivity. And then sixth one is recurrent acute otitis media. When you call it as a recurrent acute otitis media, when there is more than 3 episodes in 6 months period. Okay, more than 3 episodes in 6 months. Or more than 4 to 6 episodes in a 12 month period. Okay, so this is called more than 3 episodes in a 6 month period or more than 4 to 6 episodes in a 12 month period. We call it as a recurrent acute otitis media. So in that cases, find out the pathogen by doing a meningotomy and pus for culture sensitivity. So acute otitis media, we discussed about the definition, then the predisposing factors, etiopathogenesis, the bacteriology or the causative organisms. There are 5 stages. We discussed the symptomatology or clinical features of each stage, otoscopy in each stage, how we diagnosed it by history and otoscopy, and what are the differential diagnosis and the treatment flowchart, and also the indications for meningotomy in a case of acute otitis media, which is very important. If any doubt, just ask me.